And get you running this morning. Well, again, we welcome you on this wonderful Palm Sunday, and we're just so glad that Jesus is Lord over his triumphant church, and we are in the last of the last days, and some wonderful, I believe in this next decade, we're going to see some phenomenal works of the Lord, and signs and wonders and infallible proofs. And I believe that the fivefold is going to rise like never before. And we're just going to see some awesome men and women of God going forth. Amen. Because we know this is the last hour. Jesus is soon to come. And he's coming for a glorious church. Amen. We've been looking at the subject matter again. Overcoming fear, the perfected love of God cast out fear. And John is very clear in 1 John chapter 4. He says, there is no fear in love. Verse 18, he says, but perfect love cast out fear. Now, he says in verse 16, he says, and we have known and believed the love that God has to us. So we understand he's talking about when you have an understanding of the love that God has for you, that love that God has for you has the ability to cast out every type of fear that would come your way. And I mentioned this the other day, but I want to just reiterate it. You know, John is the only apostle that they could not kill. They tried to kill him. In actuality, he was an enemy of the state because he refused to worship the emperor. And they endeavored to boil him in oil. But each time they brought him up, he was unscathed. He was untouched. And finally, they sent him off to an island called Patmos at 86 years old. And he's pinning down the last book of the Bible at 86 years old. I mean, it is a rocky island surrounded by criminals, but John is safe in the perfect will of God. And he says, I'm in the spirit on the Lord's day. Woo! They couldn't do anything with me. And I'm on the island of Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Woo! Don't get any better than that, does it? Now, in Revelation 6, and I just want to mix just a little bit of eschatology with this understanding of overcoming fear. Because if you read the book of Revelations, if you read it through, you understand that the church wins. We win. We are a victorious church. You know, we're not hiding out in some back alley waiting for Jesus to come back. We rise in spirit and in truth. We rise in the anointing of God, and we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the testimony. Amen. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. You have a testimony. I have a testimony. We have a testimony. Amen. And that's something that the devil can never gainsay, neither resist. Amen. Always keep yourself loaded. Amen. Remember what God has done for you. Remember the day he saved you. Remember the day that he removed the burden of sin and death off your life and put you on the street called straight. Never forget the glorious day that God saved you and you said yes to the call of the Spirit of God. Amen. Because we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus, and the word of our testimony. And, you know, it's just such a wonderful thing when you think about it. You know, Jesus, you know, God put on flesh and he named that flesh Jesus. And John said, you know, he dwelt among us, healing the sick, cleansing the leper, raising the dead, the maimed, those without eyes and those without arms were restored. I mean, the miracle worker was working, reconciling the world unto himself. But you know what? Now is the acceptable time. Today is the day of salvation, because the lowly Jesus, the lowly Lamb, the humble Jesus, you know, he's gone now. The next time he comes back, he's coming back as a lion. He's coming back as the Lord God omnipotent, who reigns, whose vesture is dipped in blood, and it says on his thigh is written, the word of God. You got to receive Jesus now, because the next time he's coming back, he's coming to make his enemies his footstool. He's not coming back as that little baby Jesus wrapped up in swaddling clothes. He's not coming back as the Lamb of God who went to the slaughter, who went to the cross. He's coming back the next time, amen, as the Lion from the tribe of Judah. Woo, glory to God. Amen. And I'm so glad, amen, I'm a part of that army right now, the Last Day Church. Now, overcoming fear is something that we need to understand, because there's a lot of things going on right now. And John says fear has torment. And I said it before, I'm going to say it again. Five times in the book of John, he refers to himself as the apostle or the disciple that Jesus loved. John 13, 23, John 19, 26, John 20 and verse 2, John 21 and verse 7, John 21 and verse 20. John refers to himself as the disciple that Jesus loved. And so he says here in 1 John 4 and 16, he says, and we have known and believed. We know and believe. See, it's not enough just to know that God loves you. You got to believe that love. And John says that that perfected love drove out all fear in his life, and they couldn't kill him. So they put him on this island called Patmos. And I'm just going to mix a little bit of eschatology with the subject matter today. Now, eschatology is just a study of the last days. And it says in the book of Revelations that there are four horses that come on the scene. And these four horses represent what's going to be happening in the earth. There's a white horse, and he represents the Antichrist, who is a dictator. He's a devil and he's a deceiver. And he's going to rule the world. And it's interesting how the major nations are all at the table right now. China is the dominant power in the East. The Iran and the Islamic nations, they are the dominant power of the South. We have Russia, the dominant power in the North, and then we have Europe and America, the dominant powers of the West. And so all of these powers are at the table now, and the Word of God says the Antichrist, who's riding the white horse, he's going to come and he's going to make one world government, one world religion, and one world currency. And that's the stage is being set. Then the Word of God says there's a red horse, and that red horse is going to be the horse of war. And there's going to be a war that begins to manifest in the earth. And it says 1/4 of the population of the world will be killed. Then there's going to be a black horse, and that black horse represents famine. And the Word of God says, you think the supermarkets are being cleared out now. But the Word of God says there's going to come a day where bread will be so scarce, and a talent of gold will be the price for a piece of bread. And then there's the last horse, the gray horse, and that gray horse represents death. And so there's four horses of the apocalypse that John reveals, and he reveals their purpose. But it says over here in the book of Luke, Luke 21, and I believe it's verse 28, he says, Luke says, when you see all these things in manifestation, wars and rumors of war, pestilence, the coronavirus, and all these nations fighting against themselves, he says, look up, because your redemption draweth nigh. Amen. God has not given us a spirit of fear. 2 Timothy 1:7, he has not given you and I a spirit of fear. We are the triumphant church. And at 86 years old, John the Revelator is penning down the last book of the Bible. 86 years old, because they couldn't kill him. They tried to kill him, but they couldn't kill him. And he says he's on this island called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he says, I knew and I believed the love that God had for me. Amen. You have to personalize this thing. You got to know it and you got to believe it. You got to work it. Amen. You have to worship and thank God for the love he has for you and how he's going to cause you to move out. Amen. He's going to cause the things that you pray for to come to pass. He's going to keep a watch over your children, your grandchildren. Amen. Your family. He's going to work the work of Jesus in your life by the Holy Spirit. Amen. No evil's going before you. No plague is going to come nigh your dwelling. You are a part of the remnant that dwells in the secret place of the Most High. You abide under the shadow of El Shaddai. You got to know and believe that. You got to know, you got to settle that. Amen. And we say all the time, do not judge the love of God for you by your circumstances. Judge the love of God for you by the cross. Amen. Judge the love of God for you by the vicarious sacrifice of Jesus, by the finished works of Jesus. That's how you judge God's love for you. And so John says there's going to be four horses in the earth, and these major powers, the stage is set. They're going to come together. There's going to be one world government, one world religion, and one world currency. And I'll reiterate this. Now is the acceptable time. Today is the day of salvation. Make your calling and election sure. Amen. Know that you know in your heart that Jesus is your personal Lord and Savior. And you know that you know because it says in the book of Romans, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. The Holy Spirit is the earnest of your salvation. If the Holy Spirit is living in you, he'll bear witness. Amen. He'll bear witness that you are a child of God. And if the Holy Spirit is not in you, you don't belong to God. Amen. So what do you need to do? You need to confess with your mouth today that Jesus Christ is Lord. You need to believe with all your heart God raised Jesus from the dead. Amen. And the word of God says you will be saved. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now we said that God has not given us a spirit of fear. 2 Timothy 1:7, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. Mark 5, 35 and 36. Remember when Jesus is on his way to raise up Jairus' daughter, and Jairus comes to him and says, my daughter is grievously sick. She's at the point of death. And Jesus says, I'll come and heal her. And then the bearer of bad news, the person comes with the death report and says, don't trouble the master any longer. Your daughter is dead. And Jesus looks at Jairus and he says emphatically, he says, don't be afraid, only believe. Amen. He says, don't be afraid. And use your sanctified imagination. I don't believe Jesus said, oh, don't worry about it. I'm coming to your house. No, he looks at Jairus and Jairus is shook. His 12-year-old daughter has passed. The bearer of bad news comes and Jesus looks at him and says, hey, fear not, only believe. We're not done. Amen. The mission is not over. Amen. But I need you to let this fear go. I need you to loose this fear from you. Amen. Fear has torment, and fear is a hindering work. And many times it's very subliminal. It's very subliminal. But Jesus tells Jairus, fear not, only believe. Now, it says in Job 3:25, Job, he confesses. He says, look, the thing that I feared came on me. The thing that I feared came on me. Amen. So we're talking about overcoming fear in these last days. Overcoming fear in these last days. And we understand in this world, there will be tribulation. Amen. The horses are riding. The stage is being set. The work of the Antichrist. Amen. 1 John 4:3-4. The verse John 4:3 says that the spirit of the Antichrist is already in the earth. But you're of God. John says, you are of God, little children, and greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We have not been called to be harassed by the spirit of fear. Amen. And so we're just going to look into seven things that might let you know there's a work of fear coming against you on your path to success. You know, the devil doesn't want you to succeed. You know, he wants the fear to grip you. You know, fear is a dream killer. Fear is something that keeps you from your dream. It keeps you from moving forward. And we understand fear tolerated is faith contaminated. Fear tolerated is faith contaminated. And over 95 times in the scriptures, from the Old Testament to the New, God tells his people, fear not. Fear not, fear not. And so Isaiah 43:18-19 is clear. Remember not the former things, neither consider the days of old. God says, I'm going to do a new thing for you. Now it shall spring forth. But he can't do a new thing if you're holding on to the fears of the past. Amen. God wants us free from fear. He wants us walking in our inheritance as the people of God. And so Isaiah 60, I reiterate this so much. You know, I say this to my church so much, and I just believe it's a prophetic utterance that God has put in my mouth. He says that Isaiah 60 and verse 1, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen on you. He says, darkness is in the earth, and gross darkness is on the people. But God tells Isaiah, but my glory is on my people. And my glory will be seen on my people. And so the glory of the Lord is on you. Amen. The works of Jesus is on you. Amen. We say glory is manifested word. Glory means manifested word. John said the word was made flesh and manifest among us. The word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld the glory, the manifested word. We beheld that glory, the glory as of the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now, I want to close this morning, this Palm Sunday. I want to close with seven indicators that might give you an inkling, a little more understanding of you being fearful of your success. Now, we said many times fear is very subliminal. You know, there's times where, you know, it was revealed to me, you know, well, I was fearful in that area. I didn't really realize it. And, you know, some of your greatest fighters are motivated by fear. You know, many times we have someone in the neighborhood, you know, as you were growing up, you said, man, that was a bad guy. But, you know, it was fear. Many times things happen as a child and it is on the inside. You know what? You know, a fear says you get them before they get you. And so we see this individual, and they're a great fighter, and they have this ability to retaliate quick, but it's a spirit of fear. And whenever fear is present, failure is possible. So, whether you think you're achieving, by domination or making yourself assertive, you have to check and make sure that a spirit of fear is not working in your members. Number one, just a sign that possible fear is trying to manifest itself in you. Number one, you worry about your ability to pursue your future desires. You know, it says in Exodus 4:10, when God called Moses, Moses said, well, wait a minute, Lord, I would love to do that, but I can't speak. I can't speak. I am not articulate. I am not an eloquent man. And so God tells Moses, I made you, and I have set you on course. Just a little bit about Moses. I did a study on Moses one time. They say Moses was a genius, literally. He was a genius, and he became a general in the Egyptian army. When Pharaoh's daughter adopted him, she meant that. And he was not looked on as a Hebrew's slave adopt. He was looked on as an Egyptian. And the word of God says it took him 40 years to yield to the call, because he was entrenched in the philosophy of the Egyptian culture. He was a general, and the same mountains that he ran from were the same mountains that he had led the Egyptians' army into many victories against the neighboring countries. But that's just a little fact on Moses. But it says, if you worry about your ability to pursue your future desires, then there could be a working of fear on the inside of you. Number two, you worry about what people think about you, what people will say, once you reveal your purpose and your plans. An example, you worry about what people would say if you say you're going to start a business today. Maybe you're going to start a computer business, and you haven't been to computer school, and someone says, well, how are you going to get into the computer business? You've never really been to school for that. But the Lord is putting that on your heart, and you're doing the necessary things that he's telling you. Fear could be in your members if you're worried about what people are thinking about you. Number three, you worry about how smart or capable you are. Remember, God always matches your capabilities with your calling. Your passion, your purpose, and your potential, they all go together. Number four, you worry about disappointing people whose opinion you value. You worry about disappointing people whose opinion you value. You got to remember, you got to fight your own fight. You're going to be held accountable, amen, to doing what God called you to do. Number five, you tend to tell people beforehand that you don't expect to succeed in order to lower their expectations. I don't think it's going to work out that well. You almost belittle yourself so to lower the expectations. And that's a setup for failure, because the word of God is clear. Matthew 9:29, according to your faith, be it unto you. According to your faith, be it unto you. Number six, you often get last minute headaches, stomach aches, or other physical symptoms that prevent you from completing your preparation. You get so stressed out. You get so encumbered with the stress of the task that you literally have symptoms in your body. It could be an indicator that fear is working in your members. And then number seven, you often get distracted by tasks that prevent you from completing your preparation. And in hindsight, you find out they weren't as urgent as they seemed at the time. Meaning, you look for distractions so that you have an excuse to fail. You know, an example, you know, I had a friend who was a designer, and he was very good at making clothes, and there came a time where there was a contract that he had, and he had 5 days. He had 5 days to make these particular suits for this this company, and I'll never forget, his nephew had gotten in trouble, and he went with his brother for 2 days out of town to see about his nephew. And when he came back, he had 3 days left, and he told me in hindsight, I didn't need to go there. But I didn't know that I was so intimidated by this contract. I was setting myself, I lost 48 hours doing something that I really did, caught up in a task that I really didn't need to be about. And so, you know, God wants us to overcome in this last hour. Amen. And even though the horses of the apocalypse, you know, they're coming down. I mean, they're coming down the corridor of life. The Antichrist, the white horse. You know, the devil always tries to mock God. So, you know, he's trying to come and be a part of the whole world order, but we know that that is not our lot. The spirit of the Antichrist is in the earth, amen. But we have the spirit of God. And then we said the red horse is the horse of war. There are many wars and rumors of war going on. Then we said there's the black horse, the horse of famine, the gray horse, the horse of death. And as these horses are coming, we see the last days coming to an end. But God has told us, look up, our redemption is drawing nigh. If you never made Jesus Christ the personal Lord of your life, we're going to give you an opportunity to right now ask him to come into your life. Say this with me, Lord Jesus, I know I need you. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose out of the pit of hell that I might be made right with God. I confess you as my Lord. I confess you as my Savior. Come into my life. Be the Lord of my life. Amen. And if you have made that decision of quality today, the word of God says you are born again. Your spirit has now come alive to God. Your heart is alive to God. Not your organ, but the real you. Man is a spirit. He has a soul to communicate. Amen. And he lives in a body. The real you, the inside man, is now alive to God. So you take the word of God, amen, start in the Gospels, read the works of Jesus, amen, then read through the New Testament, go into the epistles, and the word of God will begin to minister to you on how to walk and conduct yourself in this Christian life. Well, my time is up. I thank you for yours. Thank you for joining us on this Palm Sunday. Amen. Let's pray and believe God together. This coronavirus is over. Amen. We believe God that it is plucked up at the root and it is dead. Amen. And we're going to go singing a new song to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're praising him in advance for keeping us safe in this last hour. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you. As we have stated, in Jesus' name, that this virus will be plucked up at the root and die. We believe we have received that. The people of God all over the world are praying it. And we thank you that it's just a matter of time now before this blows out and goes out in the name of Jesus. Comfort your people near and far. Keep your people safe in this hour, Father. And we thank you and we give you glory that Jesus is Lord of all and he is soon to come. Strengthen us. Uphold us. We choose to be chosen as the elect of God. And let all those who have been convicted by your spirit, let them make that decision of quality, knowing that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. And we give you glory, honor, and praise in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen, amen, and amen. The Lord bless you and have a wonderful, remarkable Palm Sunday.
Thank you, Pastor, for that timely word. Good morning, saints. Regarding your giving, for those that may not be aware, we have a new website. The website web address is spiritlifeministriesinternational.org. That's spiritlifeministriesinternational.org. On that website, when you go to it, there'll be a menu, series of menu tabs. The center one says Giving and Tithe. If you select that, you'll see several different options for giving. Three of which you'll see will be PayPal, Givelify, and Cash App. Now, just to inform you, recently we've had some issues with Cash App, and they've informed us that there's some intermittent issues, so I would probably recommend trying Givelify or PayPal. The other option is to, Pastor, while this is going on, during the hours of 8:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. on Sundays, to physically come to the church and drop off your tithes. The other option we also have that let you know, you can always mail your gift in as well to Spirit Life Ministries International, 3401 Governor Prince Boulevard, Wilmington, Delaware, 19802. So those are your options. We'd like to thank you again for tuning into our broadcast. Have an excellent Palm Sunday. Thank you.